white. I read that it's white.
Yeah, yeah, so did I. Quite a lot. Yeah, I'll do it.
He's my dad.
Well, I know he is, but I don't want... Lift that off, will you? Just lift that off. Just lift it straight up, that's it.
Open it so I can take out my bit. And then just keep it in that bag.
Do you know, did you read about how they make, how it gets to what it is?
No.
They burn the body in a very intense heat, and all the carbon and all the tissue just gets basically goes up the chimney and burnt at such a high temperature, and it's, you just end up with a load of salts, phosphates, and bits and bobs, and then bits of bone, and the bits of bone that don't burn, they pulverise them in a mill.
Yeah.
It just grinds the bone into a powder, and that's what you're left up with. It's dark grey. Do you want to look at it?
Yeah. Wow, isn't it incredible?
Yeah.
It's blue. There's a bit of blue in there.
That'd be that check jacket.
Can you put him in here? Because he know I love Ovaltine.
All right, yeah. All right. One lump or two?
This is my establishing master shop.
Just trying to see if there's another way of connecting my expensive camera equipment to my expensive tracking equipment and rig. Let's see if this works. I'm probably going to get myself killed. You can't see the seed, but it's there, right? Yeah. Trust me, I'm a documentary maker.
Dear Great Britain, hello, my name is Joan. That's me, about 10 years ago, trying to make a documentary.
Morning.
And this is where it begins, when my friend bought me a selfie stick to lure me out of the house.
Move it, you've got to move it.
Is it recording?
Yeah.
Bertie!
I loved filming things, anything. And she thought I might have fun with this new, curious contraption. Little did I know where it would lead me. You see, I had, for some time, been lodged in a deep, dark well of grief for my father. My hero was born on the brink of the Second World War to a poor, white, working-class family in London. He'd been haunted by dastardly foreigners who were intent on stealing your land. Film had been his escape from the rubbled ruins.
Okay, now I'm going to give this to you so that you can take a movie of me.
Just hold it.
Dad had always framed his own life through film, with his own camera.
That's great.
I became his carbon copy.
You're too fast. You're panning too fast.
Are you no swearing on my videos?
Sorry.
Could you do a cutaway of the chestnuts then?
Please, yeah.
And then pan up to Dad like that, yeah.
He had done well for himself. He became a bookkeeper for a company that imported coffee and sugar.
Hello.
Hello.
Who are you?
I'm Louis Theroux. I make documentaries for the BBC.
Okay.
When in my 30s I had secured a special type of work placement within the very bosom of British broadcasting.
Mum, I've got to get out now.
That's what she said.
I revealed to Dad that I'd been referred to as a BAME. BAME, he'd echoed. What's that when it's at home? My superior had enlightened me. Well, Joan, you are one. You are a black and Asian minority ethnic. Dad had recalled that the first time he'd ever detected a BAME in a starring role was in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, when Sidney Poitier had been presented to his white betrothed parents. Any other Sidney packaged person in a film was generally the first to be arrested or the first to die in some violent scene. Dad had let me capture him in his final chapter. Maybe in the hope that he would live beyond his own life. Because you see, dear Great Britain, in film, one never dies. Your story just gets older. To make him proud from the hereafter, I thought the best way to deal with my grief was to craft an award-winning documentary.
Dad? Dad?
About death.
Gone.
I named this one My Great British Dead Dad.
Where's Dad gone? We can edit that.
Turns out
he's dead.
Making a documentary about death.
He died round about here. We'll cut away to round about here.
Was sucking the life out of me.
No.
So I thought, park that, I'll rustle up something else.
This is an ideal cutaway.
So I decided to make an award-winning documentary about how few BAMEs there were behind and in front of the camera by following the press at an assortment of protests in London. I named this one The Great British White Elephant.
Quiet, please. Quiet on set, please. And action.
What channel?
Four.
What channel are you speaking for?
Sky News.
What channel are you filming for?
London.
London Library. Who's he filming for? What channel? Have I asked you? What channel are you
Why
filming?
Aren't you ready, darling?
Are you? Did I ask you already?
No.
No, okay, I'm going around asking everybody.
Now forget up our move back, yeah? Please. There's a reef coming through. You need to move back. And look off. No, listen, don't come.
I saw men and women being incinerated by injustice. How can we believe the lie of the media?
It appeared that there were so few BAMEs in the world of reportage that it's as if they'd forgotten that BAMEs existed.
This is the most beautiful legacy of that monument of death. The fact that we are now united as a community. We must work to make sure that they don't drive wedges between us. But in this part of town, when we see a Muslim brother and sister, when we see a Christian brother and sister, when we see a Jewish brother and sister, yes. Black, white, however, anything, we got a tip we had to say good morning. Good afternoon.
Whilst filming, I became afflicted by an unnerving sense of dislocation from the very BAMEs I was bringing into frame. Or Little Africa, as the Grenfell community were rumoured to have been branded. I confessed to my friend Sue, a TV producer who'd been helping me develop my documentary about this dislocation. She instantly inquired, how do you feel about being mixed race? Mixed race? A fusion of black and white? Great.
Oh, great. Hello, that is me. A mongrel mutt, mixed race.
Once, a friend said that I looked like an overtanned Spaniard. In India, it was assumed that I was of Portuguese blood. In Africa, I had been labelled a coloured. In Australia, I wasn't allowed into an eating house because they branded me an Abbo. And when I was arrested, just the once, I had been described by the policeman as being of Asian appearance. When all else failed, the customary classification, exotic, was applied. A sort of one-size-fits-all indicating, in my experience, a tantalising thingamajig with a sprinkling of the tropics, a warm breeze in a cold country. I began to badger my friends about what label they chose to apply to my colouring. I was provided with a hearty selection. Black, brown, multi-heritage, biracial, dual heritage, dusky, and is that a trick question? I thought I'd keep them in the loop on how my documentary was faring too.
So you tell me what the film is about.
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
Who are you making this programme, this documentary for? Who is your target audience?
Black and white. All people.
Which film are we talking about, anyway?
My BAFTA award-winning documentary.
So you don't know what it's about?
You know how David Cameron went to Jamaica last year? What did you think of that? What did you think?
So I'm about to fly here today.
Oh, my God. This weekend is a celebration of the African Caribbean community.
The only time white press appeared in majority black spaces was at the carnival, and it seemed to be to keep us up to date on how many arrests had been made that year.
If it's for black people,
yeah,
you're telling them what they already know.
Yeah.
And if it's for white people, you've got to find a way of telling
them. Yeah, I know. I know.
That isn't going to make them go a fuck.
I know.
What are those helmets? Are they riot helmets? What are they for? Are you expecting a riot?
Do you know what I think you should do?
What?
I think you should go back to basics, yeah? And you should look on Wikipedia.
I don't want to look at
no,
any...
No, no, no! Don't make me...
Don't make me... Mainstream narratives.
Don't make me learn.
Who killed Mark Duggan?
Please kill Mark Duggan!
You need to be able to tell a structured story, don't you?
Yes.
So it has a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Babylon.
Yeah.
Do you know what this film's about, Danny?
As long as Colin does, we'll be fine.
That's epic, that is.
I'm doing a rear view.
Where's all your footage at the moment?
On my hard drive. Some's on my laptop. Shall I stick one in?
Yeah, stick one in.
Oh my God, this is the launch.
It's the launch of the BAFTA award-winning documentary, edited by Colin.
And just as I was primed to forge forward with something suitably BAFTA-y, a recollection punctured my present. I had suddenly remembered that a year before my dad died, he declared that there were too many immigrants on your land. He had said, it's in all the papers.
The British public are ready for a political revolution in this country.
Who or what had coaxed my kind working-class dad's mind into framing my immigrant side out of his world?
Our government, our social services and our police forces sacrificed a generation of our daughters at the hands of the multiculturalism altar.
And how old had he been when these sentiments first stirred? Was it the papers or TV of the present, the war? Or maybe it had started long before, in the deep, elusive past.
Don't you want the sugar?
Oh, yeah.
That much?
I then realised that my deep well of grief was not just for Dad.
Are you having any more of these?
Yeah.
But for the loss of my full-time membership to the white world. A membership I didn't know I'd had until he was gone.
We don't need much.
No. It's very sweet.
I recall now how in public I repeated a mantra to myself. It's all right, people. I'm with the white man. But the white man was no longer. I'd been travelling on my passport to ambiguity for too long. It was finally time to confront my half-white, half-black self with the help of a mixed-race friend.
I thought people saw me as black, but all my mates say I look Spanish. Conran, do you feel like a black person?
Absolutely, because I've had such a strong black family around me, surrounding me. So that's not new to me, but it sounds like it's new to you. You know, there's one question I would ask you. Okay, John, who are you? Who are you?
Yeah, I don't know who I am at all. So I was brought up in Maidenhead and I went to a white church and everything was white and I went to a white school and all my relatives were white. Everyone loved me, my family loved me, my cousins loved me, but in the outside world, the only reference that was made was that I was a half-caste. All I thought is, there's something wrong with me, I'm not sure what it is, I've got to fit in.
Do you think this film is about you? Because it feels to me like you just got to take the steps to learn more about yourself and just to heal yourself and hopefully you can take everybody along the journey with you.
I'm working out who I am, but I had to meet a lot of people to work it out.
That's your story.
Yeah, okay.
That is your story.
Okay. Okay, then. Bye. Bye, love you, bye.
And with that, I surrendered to making a documentary about skin, my skin.
Okay, brilliant, okay.
When I was born in the 1960s, I was classified as a brown baby. To clarify the specific origins of my brownness, another label was then applied, half-caste. The midwife had reported that I looked just like Elizabeth Taylor.
Look quite light there, yeah?
Yeah.
So that's quite interesting, isn't it?
My father used to tease that I had a touch of the tar brush.
Yeah.
I'd recall how he labelled me his happy medium. Happy? Medium? You see, dear Great Britain, my world, you, had been a well-crafted chronicle written in only two colours, black and white.
That's my granddad, that's Dad, that's my amazing Nana, and that's me. I'm just trying to work out how to get my narrative out of my head.
Shakespeare had assured me that all the world was a stage. He was white.
You're such a special daughter.
I'd cast myself as the hesitant heroine, Jane Eyre. She was white. She was in love with the simmering, wretched Rochester. He was white.
Hold that, please, and thank you.
My history books had informed me that Christopher Columbus had discovered the New World. He was Italian, but he was still classified as white. If I were to avoid plummeting into the burning pits of hell, the man I was most expected to impress was white.
Oh, I think you should be on this side.
On your dad's side?
Yeah.
On that side.
And the greatest British greats of all were white too. My greats were your sons and daughters.
Yeah, yeah, no, I see. I can see. Look, you look lost on the end.
That's at Butlins.
And they were all white.
That's my brownies card.
I was, however, fearful of King Kong as he brandished that delicate golden-haired damsel within his big black furry fist. I hoped she survived that dreadful savage beast. I fretted about the well-being of the angelic Goldilocks, fenced in by those three dark, threatening bears. I cared not that she lay in their beds. She really appeared to need that nap.
That's my favourite toy. It's a bunny, which ironically I was called as a child, Jungle Bunny.
I was only given two choices, be Goldilocks or be the bears.
As me playing the piano.
And even though I was accomplished at the pianoforte, my white piano teacher had cautioned my younger self that I would have to practice twice as hard because I was black. Not because I was half-caste or mixed breed or jungle bunny, but because I was black. So I thought Goldilocks might be the more prudent choice. Dear Great Britain, some time had passed and you had decided to uncouple from the Windrush generation.
You're too fast.
panic too fast.
That's why I hired the OPs.
Okay. The what?
That's why I hired the OPs.
You're okay, that's mouth. No, that's...
They were lucky to have me there, as England is lucky to have me here.
But we have to raise a glass to mothers.
My mother was born in the 1930s to an affluent family whose land was rich with fruits, spices, coffee and sugar, in what you labelled the West Indies. She was an only child who had a choice of a river or her family's private beach to bathe in. Her discerning mind had secured her a scholarship to a private school patronised by the children of white landowners. Later, she became a trainee teacher and then PA to the Prime Minister of Grenada, Sir Eric Gary. She had had designs on becoming an agriculturalist.
The Lord be forbid.
But she'd cast away from her paradise to your promised land.
Could you see Grenada?
St George's is there.
Mm-hmm. That's the ripple up there, isn't it?
For she'd heard your call and answered with her life.
Hey!
For 3 weeks on a banana boat, she'd weathered the tempestuous Atlantic. When she finally stepped onto your damp land, she was much perturbed by the ill-tempered climb and ill-fed natives. Despite this, she married one.
Daylight come and me wan go home. Work all night and a drink a rum.
She did well for herself. She premiered as a nurse, then went on to become one of the first black women in a high-ranking role within the civil service. But she never forgot how 6 decades before, when she'd waved farewell to the fragrant shores of her Spice Island, the cry of her mother. You can't catch a bus back home, she'd cautioned. Well, turns out you don't need to catch a bus back home. You can be shackled, herded onto a plane, and be flown home for free.
Now is the time to stand up for black people. Now is the time to say we won't allow people to be treated in this way anymore. Now is the time to make the case and the argument for compensation and getting the figures as to who's in detention. And now is the time to say that we as people of the Caribbean, their children and their grandchildren, will not tolerate being treated in this way anymore.
Maybe I'll put this on the bed.
My mother was an enigma to me. Her blackness was referenced in the mainstream as criminal, athletic, sexual, lazy, uneducated, or musical.
That's Mum in Grenada.
Those who met her were repeatedly confounded by her cleverness coupled with her dignified demeanour.
My mum was a great British explorer who came to a foreign and hostile land and shacked up with one of the natives. Oh, this is the deeds to our house.
Your house where? Grenada?
Yeah, our land. We call it land, really.
And look, there's the Queen there, look. What's she doing on the deeds document? Why is she on a Grenadian stamp?
Do landscape. That's my mum's religious stuff that she gives me, has been giving me for years. What's that? Angel of God. God.
And all the time, on your land,
it's a black dragon.
To keep her foes at bay,
There you go, there's another one. Black dragon.
Faith was her constant friend.
Listen. Now, many people have labelled me a racist because I express my feelings in front of their faces. You ask me what it's like to be born and raised in this country, first thing I tell you, boy, for us it ain't easy. One of my first memories as a kid was a kind of statement that left me livid, like adult whites who you think would know better, living out the colonial mind to the letter. Teaching their kith and kin that anything with a black skin was a product of sin. Nothing better than a two-legged mule, the Hollywood fool, only fit for ridicule at school. These kids would ask me lessons like these. You know what a white people them ask me now? Have I got a tail? Do I swing in trees? Is my head full of lice? Am I riddled with disease? My dad said you're a dog. Do you harbour fleas? My fist would answer questions like these. But as I matured and got to realise these were the savages, I was civilised. How could they tell me that I was ignorant? They call me a monkey's uncle as a serious statement. We cause some abatement to this way of thinking. From the fountain of blackness, the whole world is drinking. Look at our music, our style, our culture, embraced by the youth the whole world over. So never complain or show any shame if anybody ever tells you you're too black in Brixton.
Go on. Pull one out.
One? Just
yeah,
one.
Any of them. Any of them. Read it out.
Black?
Yeah. Pull another one out.
Palatably brown.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
That's what I think I was like, in the media.
Acceptable.
Acceptable.
Jesus Christ.
Other. What's that other one?
Coloured. Brown. Coconut.
Yeah. Do you know what a coconut is?
Yes. Dark outside, white inside.
Yeah.
Like you.
Well, fuck you. Whilst on my investigative mixed-race meanderings, I had often seen the same man. I finally conjured up the courage to ask him to be in my documentary.
Hey, hi. You don't remember me, but hi.
I thought I recognised the cigarette.
I was at Mark Duggan, hi.
I'm Glenroy Watson.
I know, I looked you up afterwards.
You did?
Yeah, of course. Of course I did.
You know, you sorry. I didn't know there was anything to look up.
Anyway, sorry for bothering you.
No.
I just want to ask.
I recognise you. Didn't necessarily remember what, where, and how. I don't work like that. But
see, I bump into everybody. I don't look like it, but I'm trying to make a documentary called Great.
I'm mixed race. I'm half West Indian and half English. On hearing this classification, he frowned and then said, "Mixed race? You're African."
Yeah.
You are who you choose to be.
When that man classified me as an African, I thought, crikey, that's a turn up for the books. Turns out I wasn't mixed race at all. I had a brand new label, one that had been applied by a man packaged within a black skin. Up until this juncture in my life, every classification I'd acquired had been allocated by those packaged within a white skin. My carers, teachers, doctors, my seniors, supervisors, friends, random strangers, your entire nation had labelled me other, person of colour, darky, dusky, Creole, coolie, half-breed, half-caste, mulatto, mongrel, mule, fuzzy-wuzzy, the P-word, the W-word and the N-word. Yet here I was being reclassified with a label that held no ambiguities, that was geographically anchored in a place, a continent, a massive stretch of land that was as big as China, India, America, Japan, and most of Europe all put together. This new classification did not just vaguely indicate my vicinity to blackness and whiteness as others did. It indicated my heritage, a place of belonging, of acceptance. All the labels you had branded me with sounded like judgments that I was not permitted to appeal. This new label felt like a badge of honour.
Have a look at it, have a look.
But I want to see the whole of Africa, sort of thing.
Oh, I see. Oh, the whole of Africa?
Well, just as an establisher, all of it. All of it. Mother Africa.
I need you to tell me where
your dad was from, because I've been telling everybody at work.
Where he was from? My dad?
Yeah.
My father is Karakoo.
And where was my great, great, great grandmother from?
She would have been original slave.
I want to know, because I've been telling everybody at work.
It's Ghana, and she was wearing the Kentish 106, my Aya.
I'm finding it very important to know my heritage. Where am I going to put this?
Wow. Isn't it fascinating that they saw them as subhumans, but they were happy for their babies to be fed?
Empire, that is empire. This is a line I have. I made it up, the three L's. Land plus language equals liberty. If you don't have land, if you don't have language, you don't have any liberty.
Davy, I'm eating a mango whilst thinking about genocide.
It's the 1st of August, and every single year we are getting bigger, stronger, and the worst thing for our oppressors is we are coming together.
Reparations Day.
Oh, what a mighty good day today's going to be. Microphone check. Cheese.
Back in the day, I used to indulge in long, luxurious lunches and splash about in Pinot Grigio. There was no time now for some such foolishness. I was too busy running around with my selfie stick. I was on a ravenous rampage for reparations, rubbing shoulders with A-lister Africans. I was Sidney Poitier in the heat of the night when that white fella slapped him, then Sidney slapped him right back. Talk to my black side, not my white side, I would order my friends.
Being African, there's a joy and a beauty in that.
To some, my claiming blackness was deemed to be a direct attack on their whiteness.
My African ancestry.
What had previously been left on the cutting room floor was now the very parts that were essential to your story.
Yeah, and white people don't know their history.
They don't want to face the fact that they stole people.
And the parts that had previously been cherry-picked for your story were now left on the cutting room floor.
History has been written by other people writing our story, and these are unreliable narratives.
I now had my own mainstream media.
It's not a commonwealth, it's a common net.
They had given me permission to be someone from somewhere, and had armed me with the word Sankofa, meaning go back and get what's yours and bring it to the present.
Remember the ancestors as we stand on their shoulder. Ashe!
And I was gonna Sankofa my face off forevermore.
Questions.
It's been a long time coming, but I know.
Cut away. Then a stranger packaged within a black skin called me a mutt. Not white enough, not black enough. A traitor in both camps. A house N.
A long time coming.
I'm used to recurring rejection, but this was one too many.
Oh, yes, it will. Sorry, Sam, sorry for interrupting.
I go to the movie.
And I go. Yeah.
My whole life I've felt like a moth that you flick out of your way. A pest, an irritant.
Come around.
Invisible. And this one rejection had awoken memories that I'd locked up in my mind's vault for almost 50 years.
Oh, yes it will. Then I go to my mother. And I say, brother, help me please.
Beginning at the age of 4, and for the next 6 years while my parents went to work, I was abused by white carers in a multitude of ways. It kicked off with me being made to eat my own sick each day. My so-called carers told me not to tell my parents. I obeyed.
Carry on.
I think I tried to act like everything was okay. I've always been a great performer.
No, a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
But I wonder, if I stop performing, will there be anything of me left?
Bliss and heartbreak. Bliss and heartbreak.
Justice for George Floyd! Justice for George Floyd!
Justice for George Floyd!
This is what's happening. Suddenly everyone's seen George Floyd, hashtag George Floyd, and they've forgotten that there have been millions of George Floyds for 400, 500 years, and everyone's down with the people, and are now on a diversity BAME webinar, because we're in lockdown, and they're embracing us suddenly.
Oh, us BAME people are so excited that you finally noticed that we exist. It's taken you about 500 years. All we see on telly is white people, but suddenly you've decided you like us. Oh, thank you.
Right, you ready?
Yes.
Well... Yonder and Sean of Hercules, of Hector and Thunder, and such great names as these. But of all the world's best heroes, there's none that can compare to the Tororororo of the British Grenadier. How is that?
Delightful. Where did you learn that?
At home, we sang that at school, didn't we? Remember, I'm colonial. And my granddad, who owned quite a few acres of land, was not black, was he? Northern Irish. He was a close relation of Christopher Codrington in Barbados.
A descendant of Christopher Codrington?
Absolutely, his grandfather, Joan. Christopher
Codrington, F-O-R-T-E. So my distant ancestor was allegedly related to one of the biggest enslavers in the Caribbean. Crap. I hope this is family folklore. That's whiteness in my blackness. This is so complicated. So my grandmother, on my black side, is actually white with a touch of the tar brush, otherwise known as high yellow. That means I'm not half-caste after all. Or does that mean my mother's a half-caste? Or does that mean she's a quadroon and I'm just a redskin or a naffin octroon? Or perhaps it's very simple. All these labels basically mean the same thing. Not white.
Mm-hmm.
just as 23 of the thousands of our Windrush heroes had died waiting for their compensation, their reparations, so too was my mother leaving us, in mind at least.
It's a spare room, and I'm trying to chuck everything out to prepare for her to come home.
Her memory was fading swiftly like the seventh wave on the shore.
Everything looks summery. Towels, books, and lots of children's toys. And then I begin to see that all the bags are labelled Grenada. So obviously the plan was to go back.
In hospital, she had fancied that the blue walls of her room was the sea back home.
Mum's suitcase.
This is the archive of my greatest great, Mum. Her Majesty Fort. H.M. Fort. So that's how far she travelled to make a living. This is how far Dad travelled to make a living. She had to work twice as hard for half the reward.
Where did you and Dad meet?
Dulwich Library. Surprise, surprise.
Why surprise, surprise?
Well, because I'm a bookworm, aren't I? Couldn't stop reading. Pilgrim's Progress and Paradise Lost. I still haven't finished reading it.
That's hers, the original. How the West Indian Child is Made Educationally Subnormal in the British Social School System. A Brief History of Grenada. The parishes are named after either Irish saints or Scottish saints. Where is Grenada? I feel like my soul is crying and my ears are bleeding. Or my soul is bleeding and my ears are crying. She was into health, Jesus and justice and land. All about the justice, man, all about the justice.
We were both customers, and he started chatting to me.
What's he holding? He's holding a camera.
Found it. Look at that. Hello, Dad. The world through his eyes.
I wish Dad had filmed when he took his female Sydney, Mum, home to meet his Catherine Hepburn and Spencer Tracy.
This is all Dad's, just found it. There's about 30 reels in there.
Next thing, who invited Mr. T down in Dulwich Village, the council house.
Their wedding photos, man. Is that, that's her bag. That's her gloves.
That's great.
Their post office slips, sending money back home.
Everyone from the Caribbean does that as well.
They shouldn't have had to send money home. There should have been money there.
Bill was amazed when I took him home. Sapodillas, sugar apples, star apples. Couldn't believe it. Like the Garden of Eden.
He's done well for himself.
Imagine marrying her and then going to see her gaff. That's her back garden.
That's before he died, however. Came back and said, you marry beneath you.
Isn't it interesting that this is found in my dad's bag? Did he read this before he proposed, or did he read this after? Oh my God, it says here, it really is incredible, but a coloured girl is still regarded as a chattel, a bit of chocolate stuff to play with, but not to get too serious about. You automatically don a mask of respectability when you are the same colour. But when one of you is coloured, there is reckoned to be something perverted about it all. You got my flowing mane?
Yeah, it's got that.
With African DNA in it?
It has.
Quiet on set!
I personally am not going to use that word. I've never used it in my whole life, and I'm not going to use it. I don't like it. It's offensive
what,
to me.
What word? What word?
The word you said several times. I'm not going to use it.
Half caste means half pure, right? Did you know that?
No.
Full caste is white.
And if you mix with an African, you have lessened your race, you have reduced it, so now you are only half pure.
Why would you call a child born in the 60s half pure?
I won't be able to focus you, but the camera naturally focuses on white skin.
Oh, are you recording already?
Yeah.
You started recording?
Yeah.
Oh.
Is that centre?
Yes, that's centre.
Mum's midwife said I look like Elizabeth Taylor.
Most people look like Winston Churchill.
Oh, OK.
That's a beautiful picture, though. I mean, look how hot she's holding you. So cute.
Oh, Bill. There's a beautiful, beautiful man.
And how's it divided?
So this is all my black side. That's all my white side.
I recognise these Jesus books. I was given the same ideological footing.
This is me. I was in this play, The Tempest. That's me on the cover.
What's the story of The Tempest?
Shipwreck on an island. Prospero's the kind of guy who owns the island.
Jane Eyre falls in love with the master of the home.
You said Prospero owns the island.
Yeah.
He didn't own the island.
He didn't.
He fucking stole it. Rochester disappears a lot, doesn't he?
Oh, so he went to Jamaica and bought back Bertha, did he? Oh, Bertha. Oh, my God. I just realised she's mixed race.
And she's featured as a demonic presence. Before, when I was younger, people looked at me a certain way.
This is what I was given all the time. This picture.
Who's been sleeping in my bed?
They half hated me, half thought we better be nice. Rapunzel, long blonde hair.
What do you see advertising Grenada?
White people on the beach and in the sea.
No black people.
The white side is always trying to invade over this side.
No black people are featured on Grenada stamps.
They do it through your resources.
White sugar, refined.
The imagery, everything else.
The unrefined, uncivilized stuff now.
Literally, the black woman feeding the white baby at her
birth. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
I see you looking at me that way. Ooh, I'm seeing someone with a touch of the tar brush. I'm seeing a half-caste. I'm seeing the impure.
I can't remember most of my childhood.
I found this recently.
Caladan, a savage slave.
A savage slave.
A savage slave.
I do remember some white doctors not taking heed of my depression until I attempted suicide in my 30s.
You can literally see white people's eyes, judgy, 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 judgy. They told me I was playing a monster.
I do remember being labelled trouble at school by white teachers.
At what age were you expelled?
16, 17. And you're thinking, what are you doing?
I think it's disgusting.
You're responding to this, to what you've been told in history books and film and cinema and TV.
I was a child.
What were you taught in school about African history?
What were you taught?
None.
You don't know yourself because you're not allowed to be yourself.
You've been written out of history.
£29, 17 shillings and 4.5 pence.
Look at that.
That is the white angel and black devil.
Inferior and field labourers, £60.
Is this why my dad thought there were too many immigrants in you?
I always felt, even as a child, when I watched King Kong, when you analyse it.
I just knew instinctively that that was a black man.
And the black man was a savage. In the end, he has to be killed, he has to be taken out.
Is this why our Windrush heroes are being deported?
Sarah O'Connor? She spent all of her life in this country.
The darker you are, the more devilish you are. The darker you are, the more evil you are.
£10, 2.5 shillings.
This is going to deplete me, it's going to drain me if I fight every one of those looks. And those are just the looks.
Is this why my black side suffers at the hands of the police and dies in childbirth more than my white side?
For people with more melanin than I, it's violence, death. £21.11.
It's all kind of an echo. That side is an echo of this side.
Aged and diseased or otherwise non-effective.
I mean, it's just basic white supremacy.
He's just a black man, isn't it?
Children under 6 years of age, £10.17.5.
Is this why my white carers abused me?
Jamaica.
Antigua.
Honduras.
Dominica.
St. Christopher's.
St. Lucia.
Bahamas.
Montserrat.
Barbados.
Trinidad.
Tobago.
Cape of Good Hope.
Virgin Islands.
Guyana.
St. Vincent.
Mauritius.
Nevis. Grenada.
Now I know why you labelled me half-caste.
Dated 1838, the House of Commons. Slave compensation claims.
We were given full emancipation in 1838.
That looks like that the enslaved are getting compensation, doesn't it?
But the planters were compensated. I think it was 20 billion in today's money.
This is why we suffer so much trauma.
This money was only paid off by the British taxpayers in 2015. We, the descendants of slaves, enslaved Africans, would have actually paid back.
Your white side owes a colossal debt to your black side that your white side still won't cough up.
That's compensation to the enslavers, not to the enslaved. I don't see any white women wet nursing a black baby.
No.
I don't see any religious paraphernalia where a black man looks like an angel when he's stepping on a white man's head.
No.
And yes, then it comes to this.
Then you want the sugar.
She would have been original slaves.
Pick a side.
Black, pick a side, white.
Black, pick a side, white.
Pick a side, white and black.
You're suffering from a severe case of empiritis, but you're half black too. Which side of you is impure now? I have a saying. Truth does not belong to the highest bidder.
Where are you filming it? Where are you filming it?
Go, go.
Oh my God! It's Grenada! It's Grenada!
Go, 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 go!
That's Dad! That's Dad! Hello, Dad! That's me and Mum! That's me and Mum! There's chickens! It's like bringing back paradise, Pam. Look at you, look at your face. It's like two kids sitting here. I really feel like a child again. Sonia. Oh, there's Dad! There's Mum. Look how beautiful she is. This is meeting the real me. I haven't seen her for years. I haven't seen her for years. If it hadn't been for Dad, I would never have seen this. I would never have seen it.
I remember now. I remember in the morning picking mace off nutmeg. I remember reading by oil lamp at night, whilst prayers floated from my mother's, auntie's and grandma's lips. Their God-fearing murmurings lullabied me to sleep. I remember diving for crabs in the opulent sea. I remember watching Mum and Dad dance at night as I dozed off in a sun-soaked haze. I remember tearing at sugarcane from the earth, ripping at aloe vera leaves, quenching my skin with them. I remember listening to my cousin speak patois, but I could never reply. I remember I felt alive, more me than I'd ever felt. I remember everything, Great Britain, that you tried to make me forget.
What's my documentary about? Robbie? What's my documentary about? What's my BAFTA award-winning documentary about, Robbie? Tell me. Give me some guidance on what it's about, Robbie. Robbie!
About you?
No, it's not.
What's it about?
It's about the construct of race. Glenroy, Honourable Glenroy, can you remember what you said when I said I was mixed?
You've reminded me of it. For me, whether you're half or quarter or whatever degree you feel is relevant, African people are African people. You're an African because Africa was born in you and you've decided to identify yourself as that. So the fact that you had a white father, for me, doesn't make you half. Because who knows what your father's lineage was? Have you explored that? Has he had African lineage in his ancestry? And if he did, are you still half? You might be one-fifth or one-tenth, you know? Think of the varied complexion of Africans on the continent and off the continent. We have all had, and not only Africans, but Europeans have also had, a mixed heritage. But the point is that self-definition is important. And self-identity is more important than I think than any other concept.
This story began with the death of my dad. I miss him more than ever. But losing his whiteness helped me to discover my blackness. And I hope that no other child of African ascent has to wait for the great British mainstream media or for the national curriculum to come clean and fix up before they overstand how great they are.
I've got Churchill, I've got Enid Blyton, I've got Dickens, I've got Shakespeare, I've got Goldilocks. What's missing?
My great African greats. That's what's missing. I am part beneficiary of the land, liberty and lives our nation stole. And I am also part inheritor of the incomprehensible trauma of those our nation stole from. I'm just remembering all the Africans I met who changed the narrative and now have given me a greater sense of my belonging. I've dealt with my conflicted identity. Now you deal with yours. Even though Britain spent a great deal of its time in Africa and the Caribbean, but somehow it's disappeared from its storybook. Who I am now is what I alone tell you I am, and no label will ever again define me. But more to the point, who are you? Really?
Great Britain is great because of Africans. Oh my God, that's not going to hit the cut, is it? That's not going to hit the cut.
This little song that I'm singing about, people you know it's true. If you black and gotta work for a living now, this is what they will say to you. This is, if you was white, you'd be all right. If you was brown, stick around. But as you black, brother, get back, get back, get back.
Details of organisations offering information and support are available at bbc.co.uk/actionline.